before the court this morning is Shrakwa versus Shrakwa. Please forgive me if I'm mispronouncing that last name.
Shroka.
Shroka, thank you. I appreciate it. The appellee has not filed a brief. The appellant will have 15 minutes with which to present oral argument this morning. We've read the briefs. We're ready to proceed when you are.
I'm ready. Thanks. Good morning. I think it's still morning, yes. May it please the court. This case is about a protection order that I believe was filed prematurely before an investigation by Children's Services was complete. Counsel had the hearing on the other side that was for Mrs. Shroka. I represent Mr. Shroka, and my name is Attorney Hansen, and my offices are in Cleveland. What happened in this case is the trial was set to occur for the protection order. And mother had no witnesses here. There really were no witnesses for what was happening. And there was no guardian ad litem appointed to the children in the case either at that time. Right now, I don't believe the guardian is appointed, but there's been a guardian in this case. It's a long history of a dispute between Mr. and Mrs. Shroka, who were divorced and has a long history in this court. Of arguing over parenting time, arguing, you name it, they've argued over it. Arguing over whether or not the parenting order was followed. Our family wizard is just a host for things. And so really this domestic dispute that's ongoing, they're in a dispute between each other at the time this is filed, because the judge, what I thought, did a magnificent job of revising the parenting order, and I thought really did do a good job. In fact, my client thought it was somewhat fair, didn't get all the time he wanted, but got a lot more time. The kids were happier. That summer, the visitation didn't go off as it was supposed to, and so they were in the middle of a dispute, the parties were, about that summer visitation, and then all of a sudden the protection orders get filed again. And this isn't the first time that my client had to deal with the Children's Services coming out and investigating things. We don't know who made the complaint, but this time it was against his wife, partially, and against him partially, for supposedly having sexual allegations. Well, now looking back at when this order was granted, I think it's always okay to err with caution and wait and not make a decision on one of these until you have all the facts. All the facts are not here. They're not here from Mrs. Shroka. They weren't here from Mr. Shroka, actually, at the time either. These are suspicions. It's only hearsay. And for a magistrate to say it was credible testimony, it isn't.
Is the order appealed the full order? I mean, there was no hearing at the ex parte, the issuance of the ex parte.
I don't know what happened at the ex parte level, because okay. I wasn't here.
So because there was some confusion, at least in my mind, which might be the only place it was confused, regarding whether or not mother presented a case at the full hearing or whether or not she withdrew the allegations.
She withdrew the allegations. She withdrew the civil protection order against the mother, but not against the father and these. And what happened is it appeared the judge went forward, but I really felt it wasn't a complete hearing either myself, but later learned that she considered it a complete hearing. Children's Services, I think it is Children's Services attorney testified on the transcript, but I want to be sure about that, that really with supervision they were comfortable with even overnights happening. And, you know, anyone can make allegations. I'm not saying that there's no truth in anything ever, because you never know when that comes back to haunt you in any of these cases. But it is a real clever move on mom's part to go ahead and get protection orders, and not to mention the protection order against dad that she held for 5 years, which I feel was wrong, but I wasn't on the case then, was expiring in March. So how nice to get another one going just in time. You know, and these protection orders create lots of obstacles to parenting time. And it has created now for almost a year that my client hasn't seen these kids properly. Again, she wins every time because this happens. And it's very hard financially for these parties to overcome this stuff. If they have average incomes, it's very difficult. There's a lot of money that goes down in these cases. But most importantly, in this case, I do believe the suspicions and the hearsay, it was just that. Mom would make allegations in the courtroom that Dad's drinking. Well, if Dad has one beer, is that, you know, cause for concern? We have, Mom always thinks that Dad's laissez-faire in all these, and it goes way back in the transcripts. Magistrate Spec has heard all she can take, I'm sure. But nonetheless, it keeps coming before the court. No matter how we've tried to mediate it, they've used the court mediator. The court mediator said she couldn't help them. That's what she told my client. You know, and I tend to agree. I don't think everybody can be helped. I think, they have shared parenting, but I think they're really parallel parenting. And in this case, this particular protection order, I believe, should be set aside. And I believe that there should be no protection order against him or against him seeing his children. And I believe that it will help this case immensely moving forward. The Children's Services investigations are all done, and those are available to you in this court record, in this court. But I do not think that there should be a protection order on him nor the children in this case. And I do feel that there was no evidence provided, and the testimony of her claims, really, it is suspicion and evidence. She tries to figure out what's going on at their house constantly when her children are there. Mom has never stopped interfering, and she is very narrow in her approach. She doesn't want the child even on the internet. She doesn't want her to drive. So Mom's very strict. We have Dad, who she says is laissez-faire. My client believes that he is just a reasonable parent. He loves his children dearly and wants to see them. He asked me the other day, and I think this is a good thing, what if something happened to one of my kids and this was the last year, you know, that I could see them? Or whatever. He and that happened because he saw a graduation picture from eighth grade. He's missed his son's graduation this year. It's a horrible event. And right now he could have supervised visits. The kids don't really like going to the center. There were issues with that. And those were also maybe created by Mom. I'm not saying they are.
Did you say that the CPO against the stepmom was dropped?
What happened is the 5 years expired.
That was against the
stepmom. In March. So this is like a new one to replace that.
But this one only has him on it, not the stepmom. Does it, are they both on?
Oh, the stepmom, yeah. The one against the stepmom was dropped. We had a different lawyer on that case, and she dismissed it against.
So the only thing on this civil protection order, on the findings of fact,
is that
Zach, while under the influence of alcohol, is unable to protect the children resulting in the children being in danger. But that hasn't happened. That's just prospective.
It didn't happen. It's just a prospective. It's just Mom's allegation, just throwing it out in the courtroom. Like, he could sit there and say, well, Mom might use heroin. It would be the same thing. There was no evidence, except for Mom, saying, well, Dad drinks when the kids are there. Well, he might have a beer when they're there. I'm not saying he doesn't. No one would say that. If he has, say he has a beer when his children are there, is that something that should preclude him from seeing his kids?
Isn't
I know
that
a lot
nature
of
every ex parte hearing?
Pardon me?
Isn't that the nature of every initial ex parte hearing?
This was the full
hearing. But this wasn't the ex parte hearing. This was the full hearing. And the full hearing, I felt we were coming back to have more discussion about it when we left here, but the judge kind of made us conclude it at the end, the magistrate. And I think that this court has really had a difficult time with this case because the parties are very difficult. There's no question. And so I don't really want to sit here and attack any judges because I think the judge has tried very hard in this. But, you know, I do think this is a wrong decision. And I think that can happen when you're dealing with so much in a case. You know, I'm not attacking the judge saying bad, bad, bad. I'm just saying this didn't have the evidence that's required. There was no bodily injury that happened. There was nothing that rose to, you know, do some case law here with you. But I think the Fleckner case is important here. Not a ton of cases in your jurisdiction on this. I was looking. I'm sure you have more than I could find in the short time of these few months, but that have gone on. But I like Felton in this case. Domestic violence includes attempting to cause recklessly causing bodily injury. That did not happen here. Placing another person by the threat of force in fear of imminent serious physical harm or committing a violation. Committing any act with respect to the child. There were no criminal actions either in this. You know, usually we have all we can do in most counties to get a protection order filed when we have domestic violence, we have a criminal charge, we have a woman's face all beaten up, and I have all I can do to get those through. So when this happened, I was shocked at this decision. And you know, maybe it was to be cautious, but they didn't have the facts yet to be that cautious. Maybe just not making a decision might have been better. You know, that would be my thought on it.
Were there objections leveled to the magistrate's decision after the full hearing?
There was no way to do that because it came with the judge's signature on it, and it addressed the issue that the appeal is now before you. I would have objected to the magistrate's decision had I had that opportunity. And I, you know,
was that one of those four orders?
It was. In fact, if you look on the bottom of it,
yeah,
and this happened in the order too that came to me. On the first case I argued here with Magistrate Speck, it came with the judge's order on it. And I was okay with it. I liked the order. I thought that the judge really worked at making a good decision. And if you look back in the record, it was a well thought out decision for the parties. But that summer, it didn't get followed. The first summer that hit, it didn't get followed. But I was just getting ready to file different things, and we had to turn the money resources to this, because this is important for him. He needs to see his children. And it, you know, I need this court to help intervene. I don't think it's the right decision. And often I think protection orders do serve what they're meant to serve, because there is incredible domestic violence, as you and I read every day. But I also think he has a constitutional right to see his children and have witnesses. In an old case I argued in the ninth, that there's a constitutional right here too that I didn't go into on this, but he has a constitutional right to see his children and not be accused by his ex-wife as being the only witness that would stop.
Did you raise that in your appeal?
I did not, and I'm sorry that I did not, but I wanted to keep the focus on the domestic violence protection order that it is.
It's interesting, but I don't think we're going to be able to consider that.
I understand that, but I do think anybody who loses the right to see their children should be able to bring witnesses against them. You know, and bring people in to testify about that, not from a protection order standpoint. But we do have the ability in the protection order, and I think that's why I didn't raise it, to be able to come to this court, and we're in the middle of waiting on a decision now where I've asked for him to set aside the current restrictions and allow him to go back to the normal visitation schedule. So I'm waiting for a decision on that. So that may come before you in time, but I hope not. Hoping we can find a good resolution. You know, I think that he knows that this daughter will eventually come before him at age 18 and live in his home. You know, I think he knows that, and that's what he hangs on to for hope every day, because she's like 17 or so already. The other one is a little younger, graduated from eighth grade. You know, so he actually has counted the days till the other child's 18, and he won't be subject to this court. He himself had dealt with a lot of issues with custody. So it's a very sad story between them, and it's sad they can't get along. I've tried really hard to work through it for his sake on different areas. And, you know, there's only so much money. If I had $200,000, I could send them onto Chagrin Boulevard to some wonderful forensic evaluators and get lots of reports made. But, you know, not everybody has $20,000 or $30,000 to come into these courts with those kinds of documents. Have I done it in other cases? Sure, if people have the funds. But, you know, we're doing the best we can for him. And we hope that you will sincerely look at disposing of this protection order for his sake and his children's sake. And I think it's in the best interest, if we want to talk about that at all, but I don't think the best interest standard necessarily applies here, but it could. And so I don't want you to think that I don't think that that is not part of it, in case you think it's part of it. As soon as you forget one of those constitutional arguments or the best interest standards, then a judge says, why wasn't it brought up? And so I fear that that could happen.
Thank you, Counselor.
Is there any other question that you would like?
Thank you.
Yeah. Obviously, the other side's not here, so I don't think I have to save any time for rebuttal on it.
Well, that's about 8 seconds, so thank you.
Thank you for your attention to this matter.
Thank you for your presentation today.
Thank you.
Take the matter under advisement. We will issue a written decision, which we mail to both sides as well as posted on the Ohio Supreme Court website.
Thank you.
Thank you.